Welcome to Mighty Married Moms. Join us at our kitchen table twice a week as the Mighty Married Moms, Debbie, Linda, Wendy, invite spectacular guests to weigh in on staying sexy, vibrant, and healthy, building marriages with soul-satisfying connection, raising happy, healthy, successful kids. Conversations with Mighty Married Moms will bring you closer to the life you really want.
Episode 122.
Hi, this is Wendy Williams, and marriage happiness is way possible. ConnectAgain.org is very happy to sponsor Mighty Married Moms. We are partners in bringing you closer to the life you really want. Visit us today for marriage boosts at ConnectAgain.org.
Good morning, everyone. It's Mighty Married Moms. My name is Wendy Williams, and I'm from ConnectAgain.org.
And I'm Linda Tighe from allwellbreaksloose.com.
And Debbie Owen from youcanraisegreatkids.com. Great. Welcome, welcome. Today, we're very excited. I'm especially excited because today we have with us the marriage boss.
Boss, I love it.
Yeah, that's right. Rick Gabrielly is a passionate husband, father, and entrepreneur. His programs help people around the world uncover, cultivate, and celebrate unconditional love for themselves and their partners. Through his legendary one-on-one mentoring, top-selling books, a runaway hit podcast, his YouTube channel, as a contributor to the Good Men Project, which I adore.
Mm-hmm, it's a great project.
As the champion for a local men's health group, his invaluable website resources page and convenient online courses, and his celebrated collaborative mindset, Rick's work results in more vibrant relationships, stronger families, and businesses that matter. In this high-tech age, Rick demonstrates a level of personal connection with his clients and associates reminiscent of a bygone era. Rick lives and loves by his motto, open arms, open doors. Welcome, Mr. Gabrielly.
Yay, welcome.
Thank you so much, ladies. I'm so honored to be on your show. I love what you all are doing. And I just want to say that I love what you're doing individually and how you brought it together, because that's really what it's all about. When I was a solo preneur, I really had a much harder time getting my message out in the world than I do now as a collaborative entrepreneur. So yeah. I want to commend you, you three, on coming together and bringing your gifts together to enlighten us each week. So
thank you very much.
We have a lot of fun doing it.
Yeah.
Yeah, we do have fun doing it. And I'm hoping 2016 shows a bit more collaboration among us as well. Because it's something we want to leverage.
Yep, absolutely.
So anyway, that's great. So in case that doesn't clear, this is not 2016, but it will be soon. Yeah. So the marriage boss. Now, really, how did you get that moniker and how did that happen in life?
Well, it's a good question. I was a sales guy. I was a sales and marketing professional, still am, but I was that was kind of how I identified myself. And after going to IIN, which is the Institute for Integrative Nutrition, about 4 years ago when I was turning, IIN sister.
Yeah, yeah.
So I decided I was kind of a workout guy and I wanted to find the nutrition piece. So I was browsing the web one night and I found IIN, enrolled the next day. After a one-year whirlwind education and connection and kind of really finding out what people were doing together in health and fitness, I started to look for a niche, because the first year I spent helping people with nutrition and then fitness, and we were always told, as you know, Linda, to get a niche. So I was in the dining room one day and I said to my wife, what am I really good at? And she said, well, you're good at communicating in a marriage.
Oh,
that's pretty good. Rick,
high five, fist bump.
And the marriage boss was born. And so here we are today, and it's 3 years later. And because I had a hard time having financial conversations and having conversations about exploring new business opportunities and investing as an entrepreneur, my wife is a banker by trade. So a salesperson and a banker are kind of like on two different wavelengths.
Yeah.
So I said, if I'm having a hard time with these conversations, I bet a lot of other married couples are, specifically men. And that's how the marriage boss was born. So I decided to make one of my passions helping men open up and communicate more often and more effectively with their partners.
That's awesome.
Nice.
Yeah. That's great. That's awesome. Are you enjoying it?
I'm loving it.
Are you?
Yeah. And I'll tell you, it is not easy work. So, you know, as you know, men don't like to open up and communicate as much as women do. Typically, some do, but of course, the large percentage don't. Mm-hmm. So after helping couples for a while, I really found that my my gifts were going to be in helping men open up, because I'm a New York Italian guy. I'm like a rough, gruff guy. As a matter of fact, a marriage boss is kind of like a gangster for love. So to play on the stereotype of New York Italians, we are known to be some of the toughest, most closed men in the world. Mm-hmm. Proud of that, you know, that we don't emotional, and you know, we're really strong and tough. And but in a relationship, sometimes that can be to our disadvantage. So I was using that as kind of like a platform to come out. If I can do it, guys, then anybody can. So you know, if this tough New York Italian can open up and communicate more often and more effectively, then a lot of guys can.
Right. How about this? Would you mind sharing a story without, you know, being careful about names and people and addresses and things like that, that illustrates a point of somebody kind of traveling along that journey of a guy that you, that like another tough mafioso boss?
I can. Yeah. As a matter of fact, one of my most famous stories and one of my best friends, we started coaching Little League together. And so, as you know, youth sports is one of the places that the ego is out front most often. And so after, I think it was about 12 years of coaching baseball locally, I meet a guy who is kind of like, we nicknamed him Black Bart because he was so tough. He used to come to the games in like a black shirt and black, black sneakers, black hat, because he wanted to be tough. So we're coaching against each other for a little while. And after about a year of like really battling it out, I mean, having some ugly games and fights and just like really, just hating on each other out on the field competitively.
Yeah.
We came together, and I was asked to coach like a local travel team that was going to go regional. And I actually asked him to coach with me. And so, cause I was kind of like the white knight and he was like, kind of like the dark shadow.
Okay.
He was very reluctant. He said, you know, your style, you know, it's too lovey-dovey. You're too, you know, you're too warm and, you know, you're warm and fuzzy. You want to hug everyone at the end of the game and you're telling the kids it's okay if they lose. And, you know, I can't work with that. So we got to do it my way. And I said, okay, you know what? I'll let you be in charge of, you know, you can be the bad cop. I'll be the good cop. So I'll smooth the parents over. I'll help kids when they cry. And you can be the one who goes at the other coach and, you know, gets thrown out by the umpire. So we come together, first on the field, and our families come together, and long story short, it's about, 3 years later, and this guy is now a loving, hugging, warm. When he sees my kids, you know, I love you, he's hugging, you know, and so he really did admit to me, he said, you know, I really get it, I really understand that lifestyle can help me, you know, get closer to people and get further ahead. And really it was about his own health and wellness too, because there's a certain negative that comes along with trying to just kind of close up all the time and shut yourself off to the rest of the world. It's lonely. And as we know, it's not as good for our health.
Not as good for our health.
Was it mostly your modeling that changed for him, or were you coaching?
Because we spent so much time together. So originally he thought, I was really just kind of faking it when he saw me on the field.
Oh, interesting.
This can't really be who he is. But then as we became friends and we traveled together, we were around each other 24/7. Then we used to hang out together. Then our families would go to each other's houses and have dinner together. He just said, you know, I just like the response that you get from people all across the board, on the field, off the field, at work, at home, in the community. Everybody likes you. Everybody, you know, they do things for you and they do things with you. And I don't get that same response. And so he kind of wanted to feel that. And it just kind of, I grew on him. You know, he admitted, you know, wow, I really appreciate you. And I have to admit, I loved him and I embraced him when everyone around me said, you're crazy. You're never going to break through on this guy. And I just felt like if I could do it with him, I could do it with anybody.
So what was the difference for you before that? I mean, if you're this New York tough guy,
How did you become more
open to that other?
Well, being in a marriage and being a sales and marketing guy, I kind of looked at my wife as the customer. So I thought, well, if I'm going to make the customer happy, I've got to figure out how to, you know, put her first, find out what she needs and wants, and then give her that.
Okay.
And, my wife is the toughest customer. So I really was groomed on a very tough woman who, you know, she knew what she wanted. She was not going to waver, you know, very conservative, very traditional, stable. And I was like, you know, this, you know, fun loving party boy. When we met, we laugh about it now. We're together almost 30 years.
Wow. And
so when she met me, trust me, ladies, when I tell you this, she had no business going on the first date with me. She would never have dated me the day before or the day after she dated me. I don't know why she did it. We're still asking that question, but she's happy now because I think there was something inside me that she could not have known at the time. And now when people look back, they say, we don't know where you came from. We really, so I think I have to give her some of the credit.
Yeah,
it was a great partnership. So again, to go back to why collaboration is so important in a relationship also. And so if we look back, she has grown to become more like me over the years, and I have grown to assimilate a lot of the qualities that she brought to this relationship also. So I think we have a lot to gain from others.
Yeah. I mean, that's how it works. That's the best kind of collaboration, right? Yeah. I really love that you sort of put that example out of thinking of your wife as your best customer.
Yeah.
Because I think that, you know, oftentimes you get into relationships and you take it for granted, or you don't think you have to work at it in a specific way. And you maybe don't even treat your spouse the way you would treat a stranger or a customer, like wanting to serve all of their needs and making them really happy. When you enter into a relationship that way, both partners are doing it. Yep. There's, you know, only good is going to come out of it. Mm-hmm. So I really love that example.
Thank you. Yeah. Well, I have a secret. And in case anyone's wondering, how does one stay married for 27 years and be with someone for almost 30 years in this day and age? And when I met her, I remember asking her out and thinking, she's never going to go out with me. And she said yes. By the way, she didn't give me her number when I first met her. So for you ladies out there, if you're listening, you can't play hard to get. You don't have to say yes. You can, you know, don't, you don't need this guy. He'll be back, believe me. So I remember asking her out, and when she said yes, I was so excited. And we had two blizzards in New York prior to the first date. So we had our first date scheduled, which got canceled by a blizzard. Our second date got canceled by a blizzard.
Wow.
So by the time we got to the third visit, which was our first real date, I was really anxious. I thought, you know what? This is not going to happen. He's going to back out, and I'm going to lose her. So I get the first date, and I'm making sure I do everything right. I get the second date. And I remember thinking this distinctly. If this girl goes out with me a second time, I am going to date her for the rest of my life, every single day.
Oh.
Every day, like today. What's today? Thursday, December 10th.
Yeah.
I'm going to ask her out, and I'm going to hope that she goes out with me tonight.
There you go.
So every day, I hope that she goes out with me tomorrow.
That's really cool.
So yeah, think about what we do when we are dating. We'll do anything to get that date. So if you stay in that space, you can't miss.
That's right.
I interrupted you.
No, I was interrupting you.
One of the things that I'm doing a lot of reading on, and perhaps you're familiar with it too, is the brain chemistry. The oxytocin hits, the testosterone hits. And it sounds as though you have hit on a really important key piece about being in relationship with a woman. And that is that women, specifically women who are out working or even at home, in today's world, the oxytocin levels that are required to make us feel at home in our own skin, comfortable, happy, connected, de-stressed, are much lower than they've ever been throughout history. And we need what are called super oxytocin producers.
Yay!
Well, not only producer in terms of a human, but producer like some, whatever the stimulus might be. And what you've hit on is something really key in the literature today, which is romance.
Wow.
It's a really good super oxytocin producer. Now, your mother, my mother, her mom, all of our grandmothers weren't sitting around waiting to be romanced 30 years in. They weren't.
Yep.
But they didn't need it because their oxytocin stores got fed because they were hanging around with other women who are really good at doing that for one another.
Wow.
Us women are out there in the workplace or we're home driving everybody to soccer games or whatever we're doing. We're pretty isolated and we're not getting that recharge with other women like in generations past. So today's man, listen up, a really good thing to do is exactly what Rick is talking about here, which is charge the relationship with romance. And you're, you know, I don't know that everybody's going to be able to adopt your attitude of, oh, I hope she goes out with me tonight, 27 years married. Let's hope so. What a great way to be. And like Linda said, treating her like a client. How many times does a client email come in and you go, oh, and we respond?
Jump right on that.
Yep. And when our wives or our husbands' emails come in, we go, oh, I'll see him later. I'll see him tonight. If we responded with the same vim and vigor and interest, what a difference our relationships
make. Yeah, and you know, to that point, because the Marriage Boss program is something that I want to get out to the world, I wrote a book called Uncovering the Hidden Currency of Marriage, where I talk about exactly that. Shameless plug, obviously. I talk about finding the gold in your partner, specifically to men, that, you know, to go back to when you see a client email, the reason you're responding to that is because you think there's money there. So you're like that, you're going to the money. So let me get back to them so maybe they'll buy something from me. The same holds true in our relationships. If you cultivate that gift in your relationship, you will make more money. I guarantee it because I've seen it in hundreds of examples. People who manage their relationships properly, there is a gold in that. It is a convertible currency which you can take with you everywhere. When you're happy at home, happy in your relationship, you're going to bring that out to all your meetings, all your community service, everything that you do, and you are going to make more money. So when you get that email from your husband or wife, answer it as though it was an investment in a client, and you will make more money, not only figuratively, but literally. I've seen it happen in hundreds of lives.
That's fascinating. Can you talk a little bit more about that? I mean, I think I can kind of follow the breadcrumbs myself, but I would love to hear more from you in terms of how that works.
Yeah,
that
and
works.
I can give you a couple of examples. And I will give you one example for each of you in your specialty. So where health is concerned, Linda, people who are happier in their relationships because they invest more in their relationships use less healthcare dollars.
Yep.
That's a fact.
Yep.
Wendy, people who are happy in their marriages and they uncover the gifts in their partner make more money in their workplace. When a boss sees someone who's got a stable, successful relationship, they trust them with projects. They put them in front of bigger clients, so they make more money.
Interesting.
Debbie, when you provide fertile ground for children and they grow and you provide the right parenting, these children grow up to have higher grade point averages and they save money on college education, which is one of the biggest problems we have today, is we want to educate our kids, but we don't have 300 grand. So it is a fact that every point on a GPA will save you $10,000 on your college education. So there are three good examples of why you should answer that email, date your spouse. And again, we're always running for money. So we're sometimes running away from our partners and saying, honey, I got to work tonight because I got to make money. What you should do is say, let me stay with my wife because all the other things that I'm about to run to are going to be enhanced without me even doing anything. I have a great quote for you right now.
Yeah, go for it.
You all know who Deepak Chopra is?
Yes.
Okay, so this is one of his famous quotes, one of my favorites. When I was young, I did everything and accomplished nothing. In the middle of my life, I did less and accomplished more, all with the hopes that someday I would do nothing and accomplish everything. So let's take that and put it into today's context. The more we try to do, especially as we kind of reach, you know, whatever, 40, 50, 60 years old, where we're really getting smart. Now we really know how much we don't know.
Yeah.
We know what to do in life. So we're really getting it now. So it is a fact that the less I do, and I know this is going to sound crazy, the less I do. So if I get out of the way, the more relationships open up, the more opportunities come to me, the more seemingly relaxed I appear to my collaborators, clients, and prospects. My family, you know, sees it as a much easier lifestyle. I was at a Christmas party last night for a business that I run, and my sister is kind of like a go, go, go type person, and I'm just the opposite. And so she, her husband, who's one of the directors of this business, said, I just want to thank everyone on this wonderful year we had. It was like our best year ever in 35-year company, 35-year history. This is our best year ever, and I want to thank all of you for all you did. And my sister, who's kind of like, you know, a second in command, she got up and said, and, you know, you all worked so hard to earn every single dollar that we brought in, and it was such a struggle. It was such a challenge. And she just said, and she said, you know, Rick, do you want to add anything? And I said, I just want to say how easy it was for me all year long. I really feel like I didn't do anything at all. It was effortless.
Oh, great.
So the whole staff kind of looked at us and said, which one do I want to be in this situation? And you know, I'm not saying that we can all be that right. type of person, but I was exactly like that. 25-year sales career. My last job, real job, was a Wall Street recruiter. I was working 24/7 and struggling for everything I had.
Yeah.
And then as an entrepreneur for the last 17 years, I can tell you that each year I have done less and earned more, and it's magic, but believe me, I'm telling you, it works.
That's awesome. We're going to have to make sure that people have your all your details so they can tap in and work with you.
Yeah.
One thing I want to circle back on that we were talking about is the access to a man's, to men coming to the table more willing to embrace life literally and maybe figuratively embrace one another and kind of cultivate that kind of warm, fuzzy side, for lack of a better word. I think that a very key element in that is access by being a dad.
Yeah.
I don't know that you're going to access it quite as easily about being a husband or being a son or being a man in the world, but being a dad, there's something really... And it's, again, it's different than our parents. Our parents didn't, our dads didn't have that same connection with parenting that dads today can and do have. And I think that that is a really nice leverage point for men to be able to open up that side of themselves because they are already feeling it as a parent. Do you have anything?
I do. I want to tell you about a men's health group that I tried to, well, I organized a men's health group, but first I tried to organize a men's relationship group.
Mm-hmm.
About 2 years ago, I went to my local continuing education director and I said, I've got a great idea. And she said, oh, that is delicious. Men will love that. And women will love it even more. If you're going to, men are going to start talking about relationships. She's married 35 years. My husband would never, this is so great. It's so exciting. So we put it together, put it out in the program.
Nobody.
Not Crickets. One phone call.
Crickets.
Matter of fact, right at the end of the program, we needed like 4 people to start the class. We had, I think, 2 phone calls. One guy was like right near the school, so he could have just walked there Wednesday nights. And the other guy was, you know, just kind of accidentally stumbled upon it. So we go back to the drawing board. What happened here? You know, why don't men want to investigate the relationships? And I'm interested. You know, she said, I'm interested. My husband was interested. So nobody called. So I go back and Linda, you'll like this. I renamed it the Men's Health Group.
Big difference.
Finance, business, you know,
home life,
performance,
wellness, you know, whatever. and then the last line was, and we'll talk about relationships. So after reading 50 words, the last one was, and we'll talk about relationships. So men come to the local library the first, second Wednesday of every month from ages 27 to 71 over a 6-month period. And I don't know, a few dozen guys in and out of the program. They come to the meeting and they say, hi, I'm here for the men's health group. So we sit down and I after a little introduction, okay, guys, what do you want to talk about? My relationships.
Wow.
Not one guy talked about anything else from 27 to 71 years old except their girlfriends, their wives, their ex-wives, their soon-to-be ex-wives, their future ex-wives.
Wow.
Nothing except relationships for 6 months.
But it had to be under a different umbrella.
Yeah. So what are we hearing here? Men can't admit that they want to talk about relationships, so they have to go to a health group, and then they say to their wives or girlfriends, hey, going to the men's health group tonight. Oh, great, honey. Thank you. I'm so glad you're concerned about your health and, you know, your financial health and your business health and your prostate health and your wellness, and you're going to stop smoking and drinking. I'm so excited. That's awesome, honey. Go to the meeting, talk about the wives, the girlfriends. That was it.
Interesting.
I discovered something very interesting. People don't really want to talk about the thing that they need the most help with, because that would be admitting
that they need help.
A problem in that. Right. So what they'll do is they'll say, well, let's just start a conversation, and I'll use the stereotype, let's talk about sports. Mm-hmm. Okay, guys go to a bar. They get to the bar. It's Monday night. Da-da-da-da. They sit down, get a beer, start watching Monday Night Football, start talking about what happened on Sunday. Oh, did you see the Giant game and the Jets and, you know, baseball, the Mets and Yankees? A few beers into it.
Or the Red Sox.
About our relationships. What did your girlfriend say? What did your wife do? Oh, you can't do that. You can't let her do. Oh, you got to. Oh, man, you got to stand up. Yeah, you got to fight. You can't let that. So we start off, you know, looking around. Is there anybody watching? Okay, let's talk about our relationships now. So the bottom line is that still love drives everything. The lack of love drives it, and having amazing love or the opportunity for it still drives us. So like my good friend, soul sister, and partner, Genev, likes to say, we're wired for connection.
Yes, so true.
So the key takeaway then is wrap it all up in a bow for us.
So the key takeaway is that if you want to break through, you can't start the conversation about relationships. You have to start it in another area and work toward that. So you got to build trust. Don't really say know, like, and trust. But it's really about trust. Somebody has to feel comfortable in an environment before they're going to talk about it. And it could take time.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, my God. Well, no wonder they call you the marriage boss.
Yeah.
Great stuff.
Rock on.
Stuff.
Yeah. Rock on. Thank you so much. This was great. We're going to wind this up now. And people can find you online. And what are some projects that maybe people can tap into and work with you on?
And remind us of your book again. Yep.
The book is Uncovering the Hidden Currency of Marriage. And it's on Amazon. So you can, if you look up themarriageboss.com, you can find everything there. Mm-hmm. I have a podcast. I've got a couple books. I've got some online courses. I've got a very exciting project that I'm working on right now. We've got an event that's coming out. It's not out yet, but you can find it on the site when it does come out.
Great.
And we also have a program called Your Best Boss, which is launching in 2016, which is for the entrepreneur. And it's going to give some more information about, we call it the five T's. And it's truth, talk, time, tools, and trainers. So stay tuned for that. It's going to be very exciting. So all boss-oriented stuff. And this is really about helping entrepreneurs and solopreneurs figure out, because it's a very, very challenging lifestyle. So that's kind of like the newest area for me, is to help small business owners get this relationship and this money thing down.
Awesome. I'm definitely going to check it out.
Yes. Yeah.
Good stuff.
Absolutely.
All right, Rick Gabrielly, the marriage boss. Thank you so much for joining the Mighty Married Moms today.
Yeah.
It's a great collaboration, a great conversation. We've really appreciated having you on. So
thank you so much for having me, and I look forward to talking to all of you again.
You got it.
So great.
You
thank
got
you.
It.
Bye-bye.
Well, everybody, this is another episode of Mighty Married Moms, and we're so glad that you joined us today. And please make sure that you go out on iTunes and what's the word?
Subscribe. And leave us a review.
And leave us a rating and review, please. Yes. Tell your friends, tell your family about this, and especially this episode. Share this with the guys in your life. They're going to be thanking you for it.
Yep.
All right. This is Wendy Williams from connectagain.org saying goodbye.
And Linda Tighe from allwellbreaksloose.com.
And Debbie Owen from You Can Raise Great Kids.
Bye-bye, everybody, from Mighty Married Moms. Take it easy.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thank you for joining us for this episode of Mighty Married Moms. Tune in twice a week on Mondays and Thursdays to meet fascinating and inspiring guests who will help you create the life you've always wanted.
You can find these episodes and special gifts just for you at MightyMarriedMoms.com, as well as a link to our Facebook community,
where we continue the conversation around the kitchen table. Please also help share the love by leaving a review on iTunes. We'll see you next time.